Gorilla Monsoon. And this is my guest again this week due to a diminishing number of requests, Bobby the Brain Heenan.
From who? I heard the mailman that delivers the mail here is Hunchback from carrying the fan mail I got.
Well, that remains to be seen. But needless to say, another tremendous week of primetime wrestling here with some fantastic matches. We're going to see your guy, and we have a surprise for you, incidentally, later on in the program. But your guy teaming up with Big John Studd, King Kong Bundy.
I don't like surprises to begin with.
I tell you, this has got to be the most formidable tag team that I've seen come down the pike in a long time.
Well, it's the team that can't be slammed. Nobody can slam this team.
Well, don't ever say that, Bobby, because anything can happen.
Read
in
my
the
lips.
Realm of...
I heard you.
I understand what you said, but there are guys around who can slam anybody.
Name me one.
Hulk Hogan, Ted Arcidi, just to name two. There are plenty more.
I don't believe they can do it. Well, it hasn't been done yet. I still got the money.
You've been parting with some of your money very freely of late, I understand. Andre the Giant threw away a lot of your money on a number of different occasions.
Yes, and that man should be incarcerated for that.
Well,
that was my money.
Andre the Giant and Big John Studd have had something going for a long time, but as I stated earlier, King Kong Bundy teaming up with Big John Studd, I don't know of a team in existence today that could stand up to these two big behemoths. And we also have an interesting girls' match lined up this week, Bobby. Donna Cristinello, one of the stalwarts here in the World Wrestling Federation, a real ring veteran, against a relatively newcomer.
I don't like girl wrestling.
Why not?
I believe they should be home. If they want to get involved in wrestling, maybe they should just make trunks or jackets or make sure their husbands are wrestlers' boots
you
are shiny.
You enjoy girl wrestling as much as I do. Let's go down to ringside now as we start with the Funk Brothers taking on Gripley and Ivan McDonald.
Yeah, okay.
This is a tag team match scheduled for one fall. Introducing first to my right, tag team comprised of from Birdsboro, Pennsylvania, weighing 233 pounds, Jeff Gridley. His partner from Scotland at 240 pounds, Ivan McDonald. Introducing to my left, their opponents who are managed by the Mouth of the South, Jimmy Hart. Both men hail from Amarillo, Texas. They have a total combined weight of 519 pounds. Here are Terry and Dory Funk.
Hello, everyone, and welcome to Gorilla Monsoon here at ringside for this World Wrestling Federation event. Starting off with a tremendous tag team combination, that in the Brothers Funk. Dory Jr. and Terry, what a tremendous tag team combination they make. They certainly will be making plenty of waves here in the World Wrestling Federation. Along with their manager, the illustrious Mouth of the South, Jimmy Hart. Dory Funk in there now with those patented uppercut forearm shots. They are devastating. And Ivan McDonald feeling the wrath now of the Funk Brothers. Well, for his own sake, he got out of that corner. That's not the place to be. Uh-oh, there he goes. Terry did not want him inside the ring. He's going right out after him. Ivan on the floor. Look at that. Look at the Mouth of the South saying, give him another one. Just gets in to break the count, but at the same instant, Brother Dory comes around the corner to administer still furthermore punishment. Look at that, draped over the steel railing surrounding our ring here. Well, Ivan's got a lot of guts. He's climbing back in that ring. Lesser man might be headed to the shower room. Slingshot in, look out. Ducked underneath that right hand. Drop kick by McDonald. Just grazing the side of the head of Terry Funk. Didn't do any damage with that blow. Another drop kick by the opposite. Oh, Dory stepped right out of the way of that one in a hurry. Dory Funk, some very impressive credentials. Tremendous wrestling career following both of the brothers, following in the footsteps of their father, Dory Sr. Well, Terry said, I want Mr. Jeff Gridley inside the squared circle. Well, the team of Gridley and McDonald certainly lacking ring experience, and that is obvious here as the Funk Brothers are having it all their own way at the expense of these two youngsters. Oh, double slam and a half suplex at the same time. And it's now. Dory Force Funk in the ring. Look out. Double hook underneath. Big suplex. Ridley down hard on the canvas. And Terrible Terry in there now. And I understand that Brother Dory wants to be referred to as Horse. He doesn't look much like a horse. Another quick tag made. Plenty of continuity on this team. They've been together for so long. Look out. Ridley in for the ride. Does not look like Ridley is having a good time. Jeff is in deep trouble. Pile driver coming up. Just buried the youngster down into the canvas. Look at this reverse neck breaker. Or possibly a hangman. No, a neck breaker by Terrible Terry. Can you imagine someone naming their property the Double Cross Ranch? How could you possibly buy anything from those two guys? I'd like to stand corrected. Funk Jr. wants to be referred to as Hoss, as in Hoss Cartwright, I would assume. Mouth of the South laying that handle on him. At the same time, walking around with that ominous branding iron. In the meantime, Jeff Gridley getting everything and anything that could possibly be done to him by the Funk brothers. Look at that, trying to just rip that arm right out of the socket. And still another quick tag made, and wide open to the back of the neck now. Terry Funk dropping those elbows. Come on, referee, give me a break. We're only supposed to be two guys in there at one time. Ivan McDonald watching from the corner, not a whole lot he can do about it. I don't think he's very anxious to get back in there right at this point in time anyway. Obviously, the Funk brothers entering the World Wrestling Federation for one reason. I know Terry's after that championship belt currently held by Hulk Hogan, but as a team, they are tremendous contenders for the World Wrestling Federation tag team title, currently held by Greg the Hammer Valentine and Brutus Beefcake, and everybody shooting for those two. Oh, there's that uppercut forearm again. Hoss really knows how to lay that in. If Mr. Gridley doesn't make it to his corner, this match will terminate in the next 30 seconds. He's absorbed a whole lot of punishment. Started on the upper body, now going to work on the lower body. The right leg now taking a real beating. There's another quick tag made. They know exactly when to get in and out of there. Uh-oh, look at this. Got double grapevine on the leg, turning it over into a Boston Crab. It's all over. The youngster didn't waste any time. What a painful submission hold this is. Look at Terry. He's going back. He doesn't know what to do. Wow, dropped an elbow right on the back of the neck of the youngster. Certainly made devastating work out of Jeff Gridley and Ivan McDonald. Let's get the official word.
Here are your winners. The team of Dory and Terry Funk.
Let's go back and take a look at that punishing crippler hole that was applied by the Hoss. He wrapped it up, and there wasn't much the youngster could do about it. Don't go away, wrestling fans. Plenty of action still to come.
Wow. Well, of course, I'm sure the wrestling fans know that when that match, particular match, went down, the Brutus Beefcake and Valentine were the champions. But now, since WrestleMania 2, the Rosemont Horizon history made the new champions of British Bulldogs.
Well, that's been happening in the World Wrestling Federation. But, you know, the Bulldogs, they had to use two men to do it.
What do you mean, two men to do it?
The way I understand, see, I wasn't there in Chicago.
I was there. I'll explain it to you. What do you want to know?
I want to know what happened. Didn't Valentine crash into the man on the outside?
Valentine was literally thrown in head first into the head of the Dynamite Kid, which is perfectly legal.
He wasn't the legal man, though, was he?
The Dynamite Kid didn't pin him. Davey Boy Smith did. 1, 2, 3, right in the center of the ring.
That's two against one, the way I look at it.
It's a tag team match. It's two against two.
No, it was two against
two referees. We have plenty of exciting things this week here in primetime wrestling. And one of them is coming up next. We're going to get a chance to take a look, and a big surprise for this guy. It's surprise time here on Primetime Wrestling. Surprise for you, Mr. Heenan. Have a special match from Madison Square Garden. Can you remember an individual named Salvatore Bellomo?
Yeah, it sounds like a cheap bottle of wine.
No, it's not a cheap bottle of wine. This man is an international wrestler, an international star.
That was my first wrestling debut in Madison Square Garden.
That's correct. We're going to get a chance to take a look at Bobby the Brain in wrestling tights.
Roll it.
Let's go to Madison Square Garden right now.
Can't wait to see this.
In the ring at this time from Italy, weighing 239 pounds, Salvatore Bellomo. His opponent, about to enter the ring from Beverly Hills, California, weighing 231 pounds, Bobby the Brain Heenan.
Bobby the Brain Heenan, your lordship, you know quite a bit about this individual, don't you?
Yes, I do. We've had our ups and downs against each other.
I'm sure you have. I've heard about quite a few of them. And
yes.
This is a ruthless, ruthless individual.
And make no mistake, he's a rugged individual as well. A lot of people tend to sell him short because he is a very, very successful manager, but he didn't start that way. He started right at the bottom rung of professional wrestling, in those smaller halls around the country, and believe me, that is the bear pit of wrestling.
Yes, it is, and it carries some very, very interesting and exceptionally fine credentials into the ring with him. He's an outstanding wrestler as an individual. And of course, his big claim to fame today is that he is the manager of Big John Studd.
Yes, that is a big claim, is it not?
Wow, he claims to be the only true giant in professional wrestling.
Yeah.
However, Andre will have something to say about that.
Rest assured. The very first thing he did was he upped the money for a body slam from $10,000 to $15,000. But the psychological...
That might get me out of retirement.
I could do with that. I can tell you that.
Oh, yeah. Salvatore Bellomo with a purple Olympic-style wrestling gear. Love that European flair that he brings into the ring with him.
Got some nice Greco-Roman touches.
Yes, he does.
He's got that catch-as-catch-can style.
Well, it's been about, you know, coming up very shortly, about 3 years or so since we've seen the King Kong, Angelo Mosca, in Madison Square Garden. And he's going to be back this evening, and I'm waiting to see what the King Konger looks like, your lordship.
Big nasty.
Oh, big nasty is right.
He's got some big feet, a lot of understanding.
Nice clean break by the Brain.
That's just a prelude to what he has in mind. Right?
Salvatore scratching his head trying to figure this guy out. But so much for the clean breaks.
Yeah.
You know, that never bothered me, Lorcher. When a guy turned his back on me like that, I just attacked him. It didn't bother me a bit. You know, if he did something nasty, he's going to go and turn his back on me in the corner, I'm going to attack him.
Yes, you're absolutely right. I'm afraid that Salvatore missed a golden opportunity
Absolutely.
There. But then again, does he know as much about Heenan as we do?
Probably not. But if the guy's going to oblige me by turning his back to me.
Yes.
Oh, he's stepping right out now.
Maybe he thought better of that, too.
I think so. You can only go to the well so many times. But he knows how to upset an individual. He knows how to use that psychology.
Yes, he's very good with that, but...
Wow. Right between the eyes. Salvatore showing the referee how it was a nice open hand.
I somehow dealt that.
Whammo! Into that top turnbuckle. The Brain in trouble. Bellomo winds him up. Whoa, right on top of that top turnbuckle. And he went down hard. And he's begging off.
He's shocked. He's absolutely
shocked. Go get him, Sal. Don't wait. Ah, he waited too long.
Yeah.
Salvatore just waited a little bit too long and let Heenan escape.
I think that was in Heenan's mind all the time. Get out of there. Any way he could possibly achieve that.
Well, I thought he was going right out over the top from that move into the corner, but managed to hold his balance and come back down inside the ring.
Yes, he hit that middle rope and sprang about 2 feet into the air.
He did. Questioning the referee now about the tactics being used by Belomo. Only tactics that he used earlier on. This guy didn't get the nickname The Brain without being a smart cookie.
That's absolutely true. And
of course, they could have called him Bobby Smart Cookie, but I guess that wouldn't have fit too well.
That wouldn't take the biscuit.
Boy, he knows how to upset guys and really get guys bent out of shape. Standing wrist lock now. Oh, nice maneuver by Lomo. Took him over and did it very high. Look at this. Flying head scissors, drop kick by Belomo. Heenan through the ropes again, and he's laid out. And Belomo not giving him a chance now, really going to work on him. He bailed out.
And he's hurt. He's really hurt. Look at Belomo.
Belomo with a cartwheel. He's excited. And the fans are excited. 22,000 plus are loving it.
Up on their feet, every one of them.
Now he wants to be a referee now, Sal. He's counting.
Well, he's excited. He better keep his eye on Heenan, though. Watch him all the time, not just 99% of the time.
He's not wasting his time outside the ring. He's out there doing something. He's looking for something, thinking about something.
Yes.
There isn't a moment goes by that he isn't thinking about this match. Oh.
Uh-huh.
Thank God we don't have the microphone inside the ring.
But not only that, those words are aimed to make Belomo make deliberate mistakes there.
It's Heenan who's making the mistake. He's got this Italian riled up. Oh, I gouge. Desperation move on the part of The Brain. But Salvatore coming right back, and he walks right into that boot.
When we were talking earlier about the bare pits of wrestling, that's where he's learned his wrestling, Heenan, and now he's putting it into force.
Reverse chin lock. He's someone to reckon with, there's no question. When he's out there seconding his man, whoever it may be John Studder, understand he's putting together quite a stable of individuals now, but when he's out there, that's the most distracting thing in the world, to know that Heenan is out there wandering around that ringside while you're trying to defeat his man.
Yes, and not only that, he gives you the impression that you can do anything to him. Now that is distracting in itself.
Yes, it is. Nice shoulder block by Salvatore. Oh, what a backdrop.
Oh.
Got caught coming in with momentum, and wow, he must have been 8 or 10 feet high on that backdrop. And that lower lumbar area is paining him tremendously right now, as is obvious.
And give Heenan due credit there. The timing was perfect for that, because you can't shoot a man right up in the air like that unless you've got good timing.
Well, it's got to be perfect.
Come on, get up.
Uh-oh.
Lomo struggling. Definitely struggling.
Oh, look at that. Right in the small of the back, in the lower kidney area.
Twisting the
knee. Mount for the cover,
time.
He won't get him.
Very, very close.
But no cigar. Salvatore trying to get to his feet. Finally makes it. Side headlock now by Sal. Won't stay in that long. Drop down by Heenan. Wow, both men hit together, maybe head-to-head there. Looked like a shoulder-to-shoulder, but I think the heads might have slipped underneath there. And both men are down, referee giving a double count now.
The momentum of Salvatore hitting Heenan there forced him right into the corner. The referee was lucky to escape.
Yes, got out of the way in a hurry.
A very quick referee, too.
They're going to stop the count now, both men are on their knees. And Belomo with a headbutt and another. There's nowhere for Heenan to go, he's trapped. And these headbutts are effective in this position. Salvatore's hot. Snapmare takes him over. Oh, look at this. Trying to drive his head down through the mat cover. Referee made him break it, and so did Heenan with a poke right in the face. You think he's upset? I think Sal's upset.
He was definitely upset there, but it did put him off again. Once again, Heenan is showing that he can use a psychological edge to his armory.
Well, that's one of Belomo's biggest faults. When he loses his cool,
he usually loses the match. Yes. Oh!
Oh, Belomo right out.
And hit his ribs on the apron of the ring as he went out, too.
He could be hurt. Yes, he's holding that left arm and the right leg. Got all kinds of problems. I know his back is bothering him. But he's climbing back in there.
Much too quickly. He should have taken full advantage of the counter.
Heenan right there to meet him. Salvatore, take a hike, Sal. That's it. Take a walk.
He better.
Well, get it together. You got time out there.
He just better do that because Heenan is right hot onto him now.
Belomo back up on the apron and Heenan immediately clotheslines him right on that top rope. God, Salvatore, if you're going to come in under the bottom rope. You never run into those kind of problems.
No. Heenan is full of confidence. Look, got his back turned to him, everything.
Comes Sal again now up on the apron on his feet. Oh, he blocked the right hand. Got one of his own in. Not much behind it. Shoulder block had a little something. Look out, sunset flip from the outside. Heenan grabs the top rope. He got it. Wow. What a right hand he gave. He got him with that right hand. Quick shot. Right to the forehead. And Belomo's complaining he was holding the rope. Let's go back and take a look here if we can. Only moments ago, Salvatore Belomo from outside coming over the top. Nice maneuver. High sunset over the top. He's trying to get him down, but he hasn't got that strength left to do it. Heenan grabs the rope here, and then look at the right hand he levels on him. Drops down on him, and look at, he didn't hook that rope. He got him with a good count.
Here is the winner, Bobby the Brain Heenan.
Bobby the Brain Heenan victorious. Stay with us, wrestling fans. More action coming your way right away.
Well, let's give...
No, 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 let's see it again. Let's see it again.
No, we're not going to see it again, Bobby. That's it. We saw one replay. Boy, you really got into that, didn't you?
Oh, how many people on their first appearance in the hub of wrestling, Madison Square Garden, comes out victorious?
Not too many.
That's right.
I will give credit where credit is due.
Certainly.
Of course, we got to take into consideration that that match is a couple of years old.
Well, a couple of years old. It's almost 2 years. Well, yeah, it was so.
A couple of years old. But you beat an international star in Salvatore Belomo, which is a feather in your cap, and a couple more feathers, and maybe you'll fly out of here.
Now, last week you said I was obnoxious.
Well.
Now, look at the way you're treating me. I've done nothing to you. I haven't talked about your career.
You're only here because the body asked me if I would allow you to come. Otherwise, you are not my choice.
Who would be your choice?
Well, I don't know. I could have maybe Elizabeth.
Well, you need to think
Adonis.
Like the animal.
Special interview coming up right now with Mean Gene Okerlund.
The people demanded me. You know
Let's take a look at it.
All right, fans, with WrestleMania 2, brand new World Tag Team Champions of the British Bulldogs, the Dynamite Kid, and Davey Boy Smith. And that astounding news has got to be just ripe, I guess, for the picking, if you will, from former tag team champions, the Iron Sheik and you, Nikolai Volkoff. We've got new champions representing the World Wrestling Federation.
Let me tell you, Gene, man, I consider myself and my partner, Iron Sheik, still the World Tag Team Champion because we never lost the belts that were stolen away from us. And you look at the history, you look at the Olympics, you find out the Russian and Iranian take lots of gold medal Olympics. But what the British Bulldog did? Did they have any British guy from Britain took any gold medal Olympics? No. You know why? Because we are the best. And that's why we want British Bulldogs, because I know and my partner know we can beat him. That's right, Sheik?
You're absolutely right, Nicole. What do you want to ask him? Ask me.
I think you've got to give the British Bulldogs, you've got to give credit where credit is due. They're high-flying. They have that gymnastic style. They're good.
Jinmin, you're absolutely right.
Exactly.
Exactly. But, who he beat? American.
Yes, Valentine and Beefcake.
Exactly.
Precisely.
Or whatever. Don't get a smart with me now. Exactly. Now, British Bulldog, whatever your name is.
British Bulldogs.
Gene, I'm already excited. I can't wait to that Russian man and myself to we get that two punk English bulldog. Just like Nicholas said, intelligent American, they've been library, they read about England. Who won? Nobody. Now, Remember, soon or late, this man is not Bruce's Beefcake, and I'm not Gregor Hammer Valentine.
Thank you.
I'm the Iron Sheik.
We're back, wrestling fans. Let me ask you this, Bobby. One half of the Killer Bees, B. Brian Blair, outstanding amateur background. I think that B. Brian in this upcoming match against Iron Mike Sharp is going to have to use every bit of that amateur background as well as his tremendous professional skills to get by Iron Mike.
Well, Iron Mike is a very tough competitor, but how would you know about using your ability? You were the one that commented during my match that every time a guy turned his back on you, you blitzed him.
Well, that was my nature. Right now, let's go down to ringside for Iron Mike Sharp against B. Brian Blair.
Although this man shows me a great deal of confidence, a great deal of experience, a well-conditioned athlete, why does he wear that ominous forearm, whatever it is, Lord?
Well,
other than the fact that it's a weapon in my book.
I'm going to leave that to conjecture, and I'm not going to be biased and argue about that. I'm just going to say that...
Well, I'll be biased. I'll come right on and say it, that thing is a weapon and should be outlawed, and there's no reason under the sun why a man should enter the ring with that kind of an apparatus on his forearm.
Well, you know, sometimes people wear these things not necessarily because they're a weapon, but because they're a psychological advantage. You take a masked man, for example. I think he has a 25% advantage psychologically every time he steps into the ring.
I agree with you 100%. Now, it is a psychological advantage. It also is a physical advantage.
But it's also a deterrent for Blair. It's going to make him look at that and maybe miss other things in the process.
So why let the guy wear it in the ring?
I don't know. I guess he has medical permission because his arm was shattered in an accident. It was broken in three or four
his
places.
His brain may have been shattered in a few places as well. Both men yet to tie up. There it is, standing wrist lock now by Iron Mike. A nice reversal to a hammerlock by B. Brian. And the wimp, well, that's what they call him, doesn't like it. He steps right out. Certainly could break that hammerlock in seven or eight different ways, chose the easiest of all by stepping right through the ropes, Lord.
Yes, he did, and although their tactics we may not approve of, they were effective.
B. Brian certainly looks in excellent physical condition.
Doesn't he?
As does Iron Mike.
Yes.
Nice single leg trip. Wow, right quick pick out by B. Brian, and Sharp doesn't like it. He's getting bent out of shape. Seems to be one of Iron Mike Sharp's biggest drawbacks that I can find, Lord, if there are any, and that is that he really gets bent out of shape.
Yes, mentally he does. He allows the people to get to him. And that is obviously why they keep calling Whip. They know it provokes him. They know it spoils his mental attitude.
Beautiful crisscross. B. Brian switched it. Iron Mike just hung on. He didn't want to get caught with that Sunday. Telling everybody how smart he is now. Well, if it came to it on the street. Here we go again. Crisscross once more. Wow, Sharp makes the stop, and he gets dropkicked. Beautiful. Arm drags by B. Brian. Well executed. And another dropkick caught him coming right in, and Sharp bails out. Head first.
Oh, Blair was magnificent. The arm drags were so high, so well executed. The drop kick was so good.
Let's go back and take a look at that beautiful sequence of moves by B. Brian Blair. Here they come. Look at these. Look at this arm drag.
Very high.
Beautiful arm
drag. Very high.
Look at his drop kick coming right in. Right
in the
kisser. Back to live action as Iron Mike is bringing that steel chair back into the ring with him. The referee made him drop it.
Blair could have won it right there and then had not... Iron Mike tumbled from the ring. I think Blair was in a good position for a pin then, right there and then.
Iron Mike rolled right out there, Lord. He knew what he was doing.
I think he did.
You know, he's a well-seasoned veteran.
Yes.
When you get in trouble, you head for the sidelines.
Well, he's a second-generation wrestler also, we must
absolutely
be aware of, and he's often watched his father and his
Dad
uncle.
Was an outstanding wrestler.
Oh, yes.
Oh, look at this little rake of the eyes across the top rope by Iron Mike Sharp. Got quite a welt on his back there. He's in control at the moment. Heavy forearm across the back and neck of B. Brian Blair. He's a little bit stunned now at the moment. Oh, deliberate choke as he dropped right off the apron. Brian Strode across that top rope. Another handful of hair. He's going to do the same maneuver on this side of the ring. Referee asking for the break. Well, he broke it all right, but not in the way that Brian Blair liked it.
Sharp has taken the momentum now, and he's really controlling what is happening in the ring right now.
Driving those blows in, one after the other. Brian got to mount some kind of an offense here. This match will terminate very quickly. Blair for the ride. No, reversal. Nicely done. Look at his high monkey flip off the second rope.
I want to see that again.
There he is, B. Brian, up on top of that second rope. What a beautiful monkey flip. And right now, Iron Mike, and there's that flying head scissors, well executed by B. Brian. Sharp now, back to live action. Crowd on its feet at ringside as Iron Mike decided to take a stroll.
Oh.
Had to do something to break the momentum.
Oh, more. My goodness. Oh, this crowd, where they were up in the air, everybody was standing, and I don't know how, but Sharp is back in the ring after all that.
Well, he didn't have a ticket. Or he couldn't find his seat.
Oh, Gorilla, right. I don't know. You probably know more about that than I do, but I'm most impressed with Blair's moves. They are just super.
Wow, Iron Mike Sharp trying to figure out the fantastic moves of B. Brian Blair, easier said than done. Let me ask you this, Bobby. Iron Mike hasn't gone to that ominous forearm support yet. Do you think he will?
Well, as in what terms? I use it as a weapon?
It is a weapon.
Of course it's a weapon if it's used as a weapon.
Let's go back down to ringside right now. We can't.
Well, you're confusing me, too.
This guy.
Well, this guy has championship in his destiny somewhere, Lord. This guy has all the tools, all the equipment. He's young. He's got youth on his side. He's getting that experience more and more all the time. It's just a question of time as to when B. Brian Blair will be supporting some kind of a championship belt.
I'm sure, yes, it's patience. You have to be patient. And he's maturing every time I see him.
You know, a win over Iron Mike Sharp would certainly be a big feather in his cap.
Oh, my gosh, yes. And would that make all the critics of wrestling stand up and take notice and move him along with the championship committee as well?
Sharp now trying to get this capacity crowd quieted down as he wants to shake hands with B. Brian, but highly unlikely that that will take place.
Even if it did, I don't think it would help him at all. Blair is determined to win this one. He needs this victory. Face it, he's facing a man in Iron Mike Sharp who's 50 pounds, 40 to 50 pounds heavier.
At least.
And Blair has done just a tremendous job on him so far. He's had him running everywhere.
Look at this Sharp now. He's been all over this arena, in and out of the ring, in and out of the ringside. He's not even breathing heavy, Lord.
No, isn't he in condition?
Fantastic condition. Oh. Toehold really wrenching it up.
I'm blocking the other leg at the same time.
Got out the cheater's way, rake of the eyes.
I guess Blair was open for that. There is a little inexperience still showing.
How quick the momentum can change, Lord.
Really, it absolutely can.
Brian was in control and
he's a resilient young man, though, and he can absorb punishment. He has shown that. is not necessarily the way to go to win a match, but he can do that.
Scoop slam off the ropes, backbreaker. Brian in a very compromising position. Look at the strength of Iron Mike.
Oh.
That takes unbelievable power to do that.
And he's still up with one leg when he did that, just one leg, not the both.
Referee down there asking B. Brian if he wants to pack it in, but Brian's not a quitter.
No, he's anything but that.
But boy, this is painful right on that lower lumbar region. Make you wish you were home watching the telly.
I'd much rather be here, I can assure you, Gorilla.
I'm talking about B. Brian right at this moment.
Oh, I see.
Well, that's tit for tat. Here's an irate to get out. Irate got him in trouble, so he used it to get out. That's only fair. But he's hurt that lower back area. Really good job. Brian coming to life. Look, he picked the big guy. Couldn't hold him. Couldn't hold him. Down there we got him. Got a one count only.
He just threw that 290 pounds off him. And don't forget, these two men have been going at it, hammer and tongnail. Ever since they stepped into the ring, one of them has got to give. Something's got to happen somewhere.
Well, I don't think either one of them will run out of gas, Lord.
Well, it doesn't look like it so far.
Both in excellent condition. Just a question of how much body punishment you can take. Whoa! B. Brian right through the second rope. Never touched a thing out under the concrete floor.
He's got photographers all around him. I don't think they think he's going to get up again. I'm really sure they don't think he will, but...
I think he will, Lord.
He's a persistent young man.
Oh, he's got guts. Wham! Rammed his head into the ring apron. Sharp all over him. They can both be counted out here. They're both outside the ring.
Oh, my gosh.
Uh-huh. Well, Sharp steps in. That'll break the count.
He broke the count, but he nearly broke his head as well. Look at his arms.
B. Brian hurt the side or back. Oh, Sharp right out now after him. Rammed him into the steel railing and the chairs.
Now that's got to slow him down now. I don't care what your condition is. You can't take that. When I first started wrestling years and years ago, they told me that conditioning was 90% of wrestling. 10% was skill.
Believe it or not, B. Brian back up on the apron. He got whacked face first right into that steel railing which surrounds the ring and as well as the steel chair. Sharp, relentless, not letting up for a moment. Kicks him right back out again. I guess he doesn't want him in the ring.
He doesn't want him there, nowhere at all. And I don't blame him, because each time Blair has been in the ring, he's been absolutely magnificent. Flying flying head scissors. He's used every tactical maneuver there is to beat Iron Mike Chuck.
Oh, what a vicious shot. Him out once more. Kick right to the head. Sends B. Brian down to the floor once more. Brian just disappeared under the ring, presumably to come out the other end. Sharp doesn't know that. He's out there looking for him. Uh-oh, where's he gone?
He can't find him. Sharp can't find
there
him.
There he is. He's in there now.
Wants more of him. He's not satisfied by a long, long chalk.
Well, the referee's going to have to give the decision to our announcer. I'm sure that he counted both of these men outside the ring. Let's go get it.
The result of this bout, referee counts both Brian Blair and Iron Mike Sharp out of the ring, and he rules this bout a double count out.
Wow. I'd like to see that match go on for about another 30 minutes because there's the most two of the most superbly conditioned athletes in all of professional sports today. Let me ask you this, Bobby. Let's enlighten some of our primetime viewers a little bit. What are some of the duties of a manager? You are one of the prime managers, if not the premier manager here in the World Wrestling
Manager of the Year.
No, you did not win Manager of the Year.
As far as I'm concerned, I'm Manager of the Year.
Well, anyway, tell us some of the things.
What a manager does, what I do is I can handle all the contracts for my men. I handle all their reservations. I handle all their plane reservations. I handle all the matchmaking for them, all the bookings for them. I sit in the corner. I make sure that they get a fair deal, a fair shake. I make sure that nobody stabs them in the back. I make sure that just everything is done perfect for my men.
Well, I notice at times, most of the time you're running for your life out there.
No, that's called strategy, Monsoon.
It's time for Leaping Lanny Poffo, the poet laureate of the World Wrestling Federation. Bobby, he's wrestling a guy called the Gladiator. Why would a guy want to go in the ring with a mask on?
Well, there's a lot of reasons. One, he might not want anybody to know his identity, obviously. Two, he might not want anybody to know how badly he's hurt. Maybe he's just an ugly-looking guy. Doesn't want anybody to see him. Maybe he's got three or four wives looking for him. I don't know why.
Well, there's a lot of things that are derogatory about wearing a mask in the ring. We're going to find out how much it affects him inside that ring. So let's go down to ringside right now for the Gladiator. Never.
Contest is scheduled for one fall. Introducing first to my left, from parts unknown, weight unknown, the Gladiator. His opponent, from Donner's Grove, Illinois, weighing 228 pounds, Leaping Lanny Poffo.
Hello, everyone, and welcome. Gorilla Monsoon here at ringside, and my special guest this week, co-holder of the World Wrestling Federation Tag Team titles, The Hammer, Greg Valentine.
Thank you, Gorilla Monsoon. Leaping Lanny Poffo, the man with the most unorthodox style I've ever seen in professional wrestling.
Certainly adds a lot of gymnastics moves to his wrestling, doesn't he, Greg?
Yes, he does, but one good punch from The Hammer would just knock him right off his feet. I know that for sure.
Well,
heck with all that fancy stuff.
You don't resort to much fanciness in the ring, do you? It's all business with you.
That's exactly right, Gorilla. Oh, I could do the fancy stuff.
You can do the cartwheels and the kip-ups and the back flips and all of that.
Sure. I learned that the first year I ever wrestled. That was just groundwork for me.
I'd like to see you deviate from your style one night and do that for me, Greg.
Okay, I'll have to remember that.
Right now, Leaping Lanny with a hammerlock on the Gladiator, applying the pressure as he made a poem of late of the tag team champions. Do you know, Greg?
I hope not. I think his poems are ridiculous, and they're very immature, just like he is.
I think
he's got a lot to learn in professional wrestling. He may be a good athlete, but he's got a lot to learn.
I think his poems are excellent.
You would.
The laureate poet of the World Wrestling Federation, Leaping Lanny Poffo, right now, with a nice leg trip by the Gladiator there, is down, but not for long, I can
tell. That was a good wrestling maneuver there by the Gladiator, outsmarted Lanny.
I noticed in the last couple of title defenses, Greg, that the Luscious John was very conspicuous by his absence. Can you comment on that?
Well, he's, by his absence, he's out taking care of matters. Gorilla.
I'm sure. You're sure that he wouldn't be in drag somewhere in the building, way up on the third level somewhere, filming or something?
In drag?
Well, I think he resembles that remark on occasion. Oh, look at this. Short arm scissors by the Gladiator. Haven't seen a short arm scissors in a month of Sundays. Now, there's that athletic ability coming into play. Takes him over very nicely with it.
Once again, the Gladiator's got that short arm scissor under. That's a hard
hold. He's going to work. He's rolling with it. That's what makes it effective.
I haven't seen that hold used in a long time. Not very many wrestlers know this.
Absolutely not. That's why we don't see it very often. But it is effective.
Yes.
Leaping Lanny now trying to tie up a leg of his own. Referee could call a stalemate. Oh, he turned it loose. Gladiator turned loose. I guess he didn't have a choice, Greg.
Well, he was putting the leverage on his legs there, and he just let go of it. But if that thing is really cinched in, there's no way any professional wrestler can get out of that short arm scissor.
Greg, I want to make it clear to the wrestling fans that the championship committee here in the World Wrestling Federation tells you exactly who your opponents are and when you are to meet them. You really don't have any say, do you?
Well, of course, Luscious Johnny, and yes, we do have a say-so in a way, but we're kind of backed up against the wall when a formidable tag team comes up, say as the British Bulldogs, the Killer Bees, Santana, and Morales or somebody.
Well, what I mean, Greg, is if they deem a certain team number one challengers, you are obliged to defend your titles.
Exactly, yes.
Well, you guys are not closet champions anyway, by a long shot.
I have never been a closet champion.
Former Intercontinental Heavyweight Champion?
Right, when I was Intercontinental Champion. Look how many times I gave Santana a return match. He gave me one when he got the title back from me in Baltimore.
Well, is that the way
the... Which was a fluke to begin with.
Was that the way... Well, I was there in attendance there, Greg, and I beg to differ with that.
Well, I...
You were sort of
I was
hung out to dry.
I know I was set up, but I wasn't hung up to dry. I came out there like the man I was, the champion that I was. I took that belt and I destroyed it.
After you lost it.
I beg your pardon?
After you lost it, you destroyed it. Side headlock now by Leaping Lanny. You didn't have to be pinned, Greg. It was a steel cage match. First one out was the winner.
Well, that's no way for anybody to win any kind of match running over the top of the cage. He just proved he was a bigger coward. He could run faster.
Actually, I thought you were going to be the winner. You were going out the door that night. And the door slammed right in your kisser, didn't it?
Why do you have to remind me of all these things?
Well,
Why don't we talk about the fact that I'm co-holder of the World Tag Team Champions?
You know who I'd like you to see you defend that title against? Would be Pedro Morales and Tito Santana. What a tremendous match that would be.
Well, I'm sure that match is on the drawing board right now for the promoters, and they want to put us together in there. And Santana's barking up the wrong tree, though. He better just try to keep hold of that title he's got right now. I'm not even interested in his title.
I'm sure you're not.
I'm interested in keeping what I've got.
The Gladiator trying to figure out the moves of Leaping Lanny Poffo, and so far unsuccessful. Wow, what a forearm shot.
That's what he needs to do, just start roughhousing with this Leaping Lanny, teach him how to be a man instead of writing poems all the time.
And another one. No, reversal now as the Gladiator goes in. Nice scoop slam. Drove him down into the canvas. Look out. Leaping Lanny going up to the top. Nice flip over the top. Hooks the leg. One, two. He got him. Oh, look at the backflip.
Leaping Lanny leaped off that top rope, didn't he?
Leaping Lanny. Tremendous. Chalking up a victory here. Let's go up and get the official word.
Your winner, Leaping Lanny Poffo.
Let's go back and take a look at how Leaping Lanny polished off the Gladiator. You want to comment on this, Greg?
Well, you know, they call him Leaping Lanny Poffo. I've never tried a maneuver like this. My goodness. It's a backflip all the way to the top, and he hooks his right leg for the three count.
Tremendous victory here this week in the World Wrestling Federation for Leaping Lanny Poffo.
Most impressive victory for Leaping Lanny Poffo. Let me just set the record straight, Bobby. At the time that match took place, Greg the Hammer Valentine and Brutus Beefcake were the champions. Of course, they've been dethroned since then by the British Bulldogs. Tito Santana was the Intercontinental Champion as of date, taken away from him by the not-so-macho man, Randy Savage.
You know, like I said before, a lot of things are happening in the World Wrestling Federation.
Well, there's always something of great importance going down at all times. Earlier on, I asked you what your duties were as a manager. One thing I wanted to know was, do you have a guy like King Kong on a special kind of diet or anything?
No. I have nothing to do with their training. I have nothing to do with their what they eat or anything.
You don't oversee their training habits either?
I make sure the guy doesn't get out of shape. And I can tell when.
How would you know when a guy
like
Bundy is out of shape?
Because I can tell when a guy loses a step in the ring. I can tell when a guy's a little slower here. I can tell by fatigue. I'm a manager. I handle all their business stuff.
Right now, let's go to a special interview with the not-so-macho man and Elizabeth.
Ask me a question.
All right, fans. A lot of things happening here in the World Wrestling Federation. Of course, WrestleMania II history. It was a classic. With the British Bulldogs making history on April the 7th, they are the new tag team champions of the world. Davy Smith, and of course the Dynamite Kid. Speaking of champions, come on in if you would from Sarasota, Florida, beautiful city on the Gulf of Mexico. The Macho Man, Randy Savage, Intercontinental Champion of the World.
Talking about history. One date, just in my mind, February the 8th in Boston, Massachusetts at the Boston Garden, where Larry Bird plays basketball, and the Boston Celtics are a real tough team. But I think that if I played basketball, man, the way I am and the super athlete that I am, I would overshadow Larry Bird, because on that particular night in Boston, I was the greatest professional wrestler in the world. Oh, proud. Yeah, I'm proud.
You know, a couple of things you don't talk about, the fact that you're a former professional baseball player and also the fact that you're a personal friend of Rod Stewart, as I understand.
Oh, yeah. When he did Tonight's the Night, man, he called me on the phone right before it was released, and he says, Macho Madness. Yeah, he calls me Madness.
He calls me Madness.
And a lot of people out there, you know, they're getting into Macho Madness really super strong. And Macho Madness, growing, and more seductive than sex.
You can't say that on TV.
I can say that. I can say that. I'm the Intercontinental Heavyweight Champion of the World. Elizabeth, look into the video scope right there. Yes. Look into the video scope and see how proud you are to be the manager of the Macho Man.
I am proud to be the manager of the Macho Man.
Want to ask her a question?
You've told me I can't talk to her, Randy.
I've told you that from time to time. Yes, I have. Would you like to ask her a question right at this particular time? Would you like to do that?
May I?
Oh, yeah. What kind of a question you want to ask her?
Well, Elizabeth.
You wouldn't give her that flower, would you?
Oh.
If you did that, you know what would happen?
Yeah, I've got a good idea.
You know what would happen if Okerlund gave a flower to Elizabeth? Elizabeth, do you know what would happen?
Well, don't get her in the middle of this. She doesn't.
Man, I think that your time is done, and I think that the spotlight should go on top of me. Yeah. And I'll tell you what. Tito Santana, too bad. Hulk Hogan, too bad, too. Because you're all in one category. You're all great wrestlers, but you're all not as good as the Macho Man, Randy Savage.
Thank you, gentleman, who obviously has a very high opinion of himself, the Macho Man, Randy Savage.
It's time for the ladies on Primetime Wrestling. Linda Gonzalez, I think she's been... No, give me C. I think she's been in the ranks of a professional now for some 6 months against a real veteran in Donna Cristinello.
C.
That's what I figured you'd say. It's going to be tough to get some intelligent answers from Bobby the Brain Heenan this week here on Primetime
Pretty
Wrestling.
Tough to get an intelligent question, too.
We'll do the best that we can. Right now, let's go down to ringside for this tremendous ladies' match. This way.
It is scheduled for one fall. Introducing first, to my left, from Pittsburgh, Pennsylvania, weighing 159 pounds, Donna Cristinello. And her opponent, out of Rockdale, Texas, weighing 145 pounds, Linda Gonzalez.
Hello, everyone, and welcome. Gorilla Monsoon here at ringside with Greg the Hammer Valentine and luscious Johnny Valiant. We're just missing one ingredient from that entire World Wrestling Federation Tag Team Championship team.
Well, just let me guess who it may be. I would say off the top of my hat, Mr. Monsoon, I would say it's Brutus Beefcake.
Brutai is very conspicuous by his absence, as you have been on a number of occasions when your title was on the line, John.
Well, Mr. Monsoon, you know, I have complete confidence in my two wrestlers here. The Dream Team, of course, one half of the Tag Team Champions. Of course, we're talking to my media right here, Greg the Hammer Valentine, who's on the audio portion, along with yours truly, luscious Johnny Valiant.
Thank you,
Johnny. Yes, sir, anytime. Of course, Brutus Beefcake. I feel that in my absence, Greg the Hammer Valentine can pitch in there or pinch hit for me admirably with any given occasion. No trouble.
That's more or less. I am the captain of the team. Of course, Brutus Beefcake, the younger, more fresher athlete. And I am coaching along, and he's doing one hell of a job.
You better believe it.
Linda Gonzalez having some success here with that step-over toe hold. You hardly see this hold much anymore either. Donna Cristinello.
Well, I think girls and ladies of this nature ought to stay at home in the kitchen instead of in the ring.
You would actually feel that way, Grant?
Yes, I do.
In other words, if you were married, you wouldn't want your wife to be out there inside the squared circle.
Of course not.
You figure you want to be the breadwinner, right?
Right, it's a man's job.
Uh-huh.
You know, I wouldn't want to do what a woman does, sit around and wash dishes and
I don't think you'd take care of babies
and stuff like that.
I don't think you'd say that, Greg, if the fabulous one were sitting here, Moolah.
What does the fabulous one got to do with me, or why would I worry about that?
She's liable to take a shot at you, that's why.
She looks like the Wicked Witch of the North anyway.
Oh, my God.
They say only her mother can love that face.
I don't even think her mother loves her.
Linda Gonzalez having her problems, but now gets the upper hand on Donna Cristinello, as once again the World Wrestling Federation and the superstars of it invade. And as always, action and excitement personified.
Mr. Monsoon, you know, this Donna Cristinello, she's been around a number of years. I know I've been on many a card throughout the Northeast section of the United States, and I've noticed that Donna has appeared on several of the cards. And
from Pittsburgh, is she not?
That's what I understand.
Yeah. Looks like some of her lipstick on the mat.
Look like it. Some eyeshadow or some lipstick on the mat there.
It might be some blood maybe at one occasion you left out there, Greg. I notice a lot of your blood's been shed in a lot of arenas.
Wait a minute, Gorilla. Why do I have to sit here and take this verbal abuse from you?
You don't have to sit here. You can leave if you like.
I want him here. I like Greg the Hammer Valentine here.
I'm glad you guys came out here and joined me this week.
Well, it's our pleasure to be here. It's your pleasure equally as well, Mr. Monsoon.
I happen to be in attendance at the Philadelphia Spectrum when you guys literally stole the title.
What do you mean?
We stole the audience.
You
captured
the title.
The show.
Stole the title. Well, I'll tell you, that's a bunch of sour grapes.
Well, will you sit there and deny that you got involved in that match?
Yes, I'll sit here and deny. Well, that's like locking the barn door after the horse is gone.
Well, I happened to be sitting at ringside doing commentary that particular evening, and I saw exactly what you did and was very unorthodox, to say the least.
You know something?
You were very candid, to say the least.
Conspicuous may be one part of the best way to describe that, just like Cristinello is here. She's taking advantage of a situation, such as I took advantage of a situation, and Greg the Hammer capitalized on it, and when the smoke cleared,
that's right.
Barry Windham is no longer in pro wrestling.
When the smoke literally cleared.
Well, yeah, there was a lot of people smoking at ringside. They do smoke.
Of which you were one of them.
Me smoke? I'm not a smoker, sir. I don't smoke nor drink.
You always have a cigar sticking in your face, John.
I do?
Yes.
Well, now and then I do
take a drink. It's just something for his... somewhere for him to play with his hands, you know. That's
uh-huh.
how it is.
Donna Cristinello, the ring veteran, going after the newcomer, Linda Gonzalez. And right now, Linda with a nice arm wringer going to work. Oh, flips Donna right over into an arm stretcher here.
You know, she's kind of cute, I think, this Linda.
Donna? Donna?
No, not Donna. I'm looking at the other girl there.
Wait a minute, John.
Linda Gonzalez.
Maybe you better
Linda
take
Gonzalez.
Those sunglasses off.
Yeah, let me take the sunglasses off.
So you got a better perspective.
I think I better put them back on in just a second. She's not that, well, not that cute.
Donna holding on to the top rope, but to no avail.
What's that story? The girls get better looking towards closing time?
Yeah, that's it.
This is the third match, right?
Holding on to the top rope once more for a little extra leverage. Referee Dick Kroll, that is not his job. His job is not to get involved physically with the wrestlers. Look out, Donna hard into the corner, and Linda comes in, but... sort of telegraphed that move quite a few feet across the ring.
Oh,
there's another one and another one.
I don't know if you've noticed it about Monsoon, but Dick's kind of peeking around there awfully close in this match tonight.
Backdrop,
more so.
Leapfrog over the top, look out, forced inside. Roll up for Sunset Flip. She could get her here with the big bridge. Yes.
Nicely done, my dear. Very nicely done.
The ring veteran getting beaten here by the newcomer. Linda Gonzalez, tremendous victory here for her here in the World Wrestling Federation. Let's go up to our ring announcer.
Here is your winner, Linda Gonzalez.
Linda Gonzalez, what a very effective debut.
I would say her Latin blood certainly was.
She was lucky.
She was lucky. Let's go back to the video replay. You want to call this action, luscious one?
Well, she pitches the girl into the center ropes. She goes to give her a backdrop. Leapfrogs her, pushes her in, gives her the old Pat O'Connor, if you will, victory roll-up.
and she's on top of her man, in this case girl, for one, two, three.
Nice bridge on the part of Linda Gonzalez, making her debut here in the World Wrestling Federation, and a very effective one at that.
Wow, very impressive victory for Linda Gonzalez over, you know, a strong opponent. Donna Cristinello, been around quite a while.
You know, the more I look at that Gonzalez lady, she looks a little bit like Santana.
Well,
she might be an aunt of his or something.
Highly unlikely.
They look like they could be related.
Robert, that would happen. Let's go over some of the ramifications of WrestleMania 2. The obvious ones, of course, history made in Chicago as the British Bulldogs dethroned Brutus Beefcake and Greg the Hammer Valentine. The Fabulous Moolah successfully holding on to her title. The Macho Man holding on to his title. Your man had to eat a lot of words, didn't he?
Oh, my man did.
Your man.
You like to rub it in, don't you?
King Kong Bundy, he said an awful lot of derogatory things and made a lot of strong statements that never happened.
But he was also, Hulk Hogan that was carried out of the ring in Phoenix and taken to the hospital. And we would have been the world's champion right now had that been a regulation door on that cage.
You guys,
nobody's telling me. I could barely get in that cage. I could barely get in a cage. Tommy the Thorn could barely get out of the cage.
We'll be back.
I'm going to talk about this.
It's that time on Primetime Wrestling for Tag Team Action, and we're going to see two of the greats in the world of professional wrestling doing their thing, Mr. USA Tony Atlas and Tony Garea.
You know, a lot of people think Tony Atlas is dumb.
Why is that?
Well, a lot of people just do. You know, he can speak French. The other day I heard him say Coupe de Ville.
Oh, please.
Yeah, he's no dummy as far as I'm concerned.
Oh, my God. I would like to see two of your guys team up against this pair, but right now we're going to take a look at these two. Let's go down the ringside.
Tag team match scheduled for one fall. In the ring, to my right, from Brooklyn, New York, weighing 248 pounds, Steve Lombardi. His partner from parts unknown, weighing 251 pounds, The Menace. Their opponents, from Roanoke, Virginia, at 250 pounds, Tony Atlas. His partner from Auckland, New Zealand, weighing 245 pounds, Tony Garea.
Hello, everyone, and welcome. Gorilla Monsoon here at ringside, and joining me this week here in the World Wrestling Federation microphones, NFL great and former superstar in the world of professional wrestling, Ernie Ladd. Welcome, Ernie.
Well, that's great. You got a seasoned veteran in that ring in Tony Garea. Been world's champion tag team partner on many, many occasions.
Five different times.
That is fantastic.
It doesn't happen by accident when you do it that many times. Crisscross here. Oh! Lombardi made a crossover, ran right into a beautiful knee by Tony. Quite unexpected. Nice reversal on the hip lock.
Tony has so many moves that he can counter you with. This is one of the things that made him champion so many times. He come right back and counter, and then he's smart. He tags right out to a fresh man in Tony Atlas. I let Tony Atlas go to work on him. Tony Atlas is a seasoned veteran also.
Well, and he spent a lot of time in the gym.
Yes, and this is what makes the athlete.
Oh, look at the leapfrog, the agility, and another one. Drop down, monkey flip, yes.
Great move by Tony Atlas. You can see why he was such a great athlete. Great moves, great power.
Also had a tremendous amateur background, did he not, Ernie?
Yes, he did. Yes, he did. You know, any NFL team would be proud to have a middle linebacker like that. But he chose the greatest sport in the world, professional wrestling.
And the wrestling fans certainly are well aware of that. Uh-oh, look at this. You're going to find out who's underneath there. The Menace. No, he scoots out under the bottom rope.
The
Atlas
Menace
wanted to take a look at him.
Oh, yes. And the fans wanted him to take the mask off. And he took the skids.
He's out there thinking about it. Of course, Lombardi here has been around the World Wrestling Federation now for over a year. And he's made some tremendous strides. Quick tag again as Garea back in again. It shows you the continuity this team has. So many teams forming now, Ernie. Of course, with the history that was made in WrestleMania 2, the British Bulldogs capturing the World Wrestling Federation title away from Brutus Beefcake and Greg Valentine, it's brought a whole new interest into tag team competition.
Well, it tells you have an opportunity. If you have something that's good, and you come to World Wrestling Federation, you will get the opportunity to show or excel if you have the qualities. And the British Bulldogs, they proved that point. They told everybody that they were good enough to be world champions. Lua Banner has taken many, many a team to the championship, and it just happened one more time in Lua Banner's case. What a great manager Lua has been over the years. You might have liked him sometime, you might have disliked him, but you cannot dispute that Lua Banner has taken his teams to the championship.
Certainly no question about that. Gurria in control now with the menace. Of course, everyone knows 16 times Albano brought different teams to the title.
Make him the greatest manager of all time.
Undoubtedly.
As far as I'm concerned.
Look out, double team effort over the top. Watch out. Power slam, yes. The menace in a lot of trouble here. Gurria right on top of the case of Steve Lombardi. And Atlas with a big splash. Get the hot shower ready. This one's over.
This ball game's over.
Look at the big smile on Tony's face. He's happy inside the ring, outside the ring, and he's got a tremendous partner in Tony Gurria. We expect great things from this particular team. Let's get the official word.
The winners of this contest, Tony Atlas and Tony Gurria.
Talk about two greats in the world of professional wrestling. You're looking at two of them right there.
Oh, yes, without a shadow of a doubt. If they work together a couple more times, they'd be a team that's unbelievable to beat.
Hot team. We're going to be seeing a lot more of them. Let me ask you this, Bill. I know that you're very close and very good friends with Luscious John. I'm sure you've talked to him since WrestleMania 2.
Yes, I have.
What did he have to say? Enlighten the
prime-time
viewers.
He didn't like the idea of having two referees. He didn't like the idea of Ozzy Osbourne.
Well, one of the ideas for two referees is because he's out there.
What about Lou Albano? He's broke every rule. They named rules after him. They made rules because of that man.
Well, that's I'll have
yes.
to agree with you.
Of
yes.
course you'll have to agree with yes. me. I'm always right.
No, but I didn't say that.
I said that.
Oh,
you
okay.
don't have to say
give
it. I know
give me some other thoughts.
Okay, another thing. He said Valentine was in the ring. He was the legal man. Dynamite Kid was not the legal man, but he was instrumental. And then and it was a fast count, too, I heard.
No, it was not a fast count.
Well, now, you asked me a question, and now you think I'm a liar.
No, you said you think it was a fast count. I'm telling you it wasn't
I'm
because
you,
I was
John
there.
Told me it was.
Plenty of hot tag team action here in the World Wrestling Federation and right here on Primetime Wrestling, all because, of, I think, because of the new champions that were just formed.
Yes, the British Bulldogs, they look beatable. They look like they can be beaten.
Anybody can be beaten, Bobby.
Not Bundy or Studd. They can't be slammed. They're the only team in wrestling that can't be slammed. They have a combined weight of over 800 pounds.
Just because you can't be slammed does not mean you can't be beaten. And your men can be slammed.
They can't be slammed. Every time you ask me a question, you answer it.
Let's take a look at the Hart Foundation. Let's go to ringside.
This is a tag team match scheduled for one fall. Introducing to my left, the manager, the Mouth of the South, Jimmy Hart. And Jimmy Hart presents from Calgary, Alberta, Canada, weighing 231 pounds, Bret Hitman Hart. His partner from Reno, Nevada, at 280 pounds, Jim the Anvil Neidhart. Their opponents from Providence, Rhode Island, at 234 pounds, Ron D. And from Hoboken, New Jersey, weighing 235 pounds, Mario Mancini.
Mario Mancini getting a big hand, Gorilla Monsoon here at ringside, and these two individuals, Jim the Anvil Neidhart, and Hitman Bret Hart. What a formidable team put together by the Mouth of the South, Jimmy Hart. They are rapidly climbing the ladder to success here in the World Wrestling Federation and will not be satisfied until they get their hands on the World Wrestling Federation tag team title currently held by Barry Windham and Mike Rotundo. Mancini in there with Neidhart at the moment. Quick tag made. Continuity very, very good on the part of Hart and Neidhart. Of course, at ringside constantly with that horrid megaphone of his, the Mouth of the South, Certainly didn't need the megaphone for that individual. Elbow off the ropes by the Hitman. Wow! Drops the leg right across the esophagus. Mario Mancini not faring too well. Snap Mare takes him over. Certainly can be very distracting. Look at that individual who not only irritates the wrestling fans, but irritates the opponents of these two individuals. And it's quite unfair. He should be sent back to the dressing room immediately. It's like a handicap match when you've got that individual out there. Mancini with an elbow manages to break loose from the Hitman. Look out. Snapmare once more takes him over. Ronnie D wanting to get into this match, and I'm sure he will very shortly. Right now, the Hart Foundation doing a number on Mario Mancini. There's another quick tag. 300 pounds plus, Jim the Anvil Neidhart. Backbreaker and a beauty. Look out! Off the second turnbuckle from the inside, the Hitman dropped right on the throat once more. Wow, that was just not just a slam. He drove him down into the canvas. Blake chokehold right in front of the referee. No need for that. These guys will do whatever is necessary to win a match. They pull out all the stops. That's 305 pounds plus, and they're lowering the boom now. Mario Mancini still waiting to get in. Ronnie D. Mancini tried to mount some sort of offense there, but not successful as the Behemoth just battered us and back down to the canvas once more. Look out. Out onto the concrete floor goes Mancini. And the Hitman right out after him. No, not on the concrete. Ah. Luckily, feet came down first there, and that could have terminated this youngster's career. Mouth of the South being aggravated once more. Ronnie D comes around, checking out his partner. He certainly looks the worst for wear. Runs right into the anvil, and look at this double team action here. Is all four men now on the arena floor. Mancini gets thrown back in. Ronnie D bit the dust on the other side. This is a real wrecking crew. They will stop short at nothing to get victory. Oh, nice drop kick there by the Hitman. Spario was held helpless by the hair as the anvil's giving them a real lesson. Right hand, two of them, three of them. Hasn't really hurt the big guy yet. One right to the nose. That may slow him down just a little bit. There's the tag. Ronnie D comes in. Let's see what he can do. Took a side headlock. You're not going to control the big guy that way. Another quick tag made him wide open. Ronnie D gets suckered right in the lower abdomen. Double team effort now. Oh, look at the clothesline. The Hitman off the turnbuckles. Came right across with a beautiful clothesline, and a three count came easy as Ronnie D didn't show us a whole heck of a lot. Jimmy Hart is static about his victory. Let's get the official word.
Your winners, the team of Bret Hitman Hart and Jim the Anvil Neidhart.
These two guys are certainly going to be something to be reckoned with here in the World Wrestling Federation, as they've got their sights set on one thing, and that's that title, that coveted title, which means the dollars and cents, folks. And unfortunately, Ronnie D was used as a stepping stone towards the title. Let's go back and take a look how he was easily polished off here. Double team effort. Has a five-time count to get out of there. Look at this. Wow, what a clothesline. Down for the cover. The Anvil makes the exit in time. A double team effort and victorious. Once again here in the World Wrestling Federation.
Wow, a tremendous team, the Hart Foundation. I understand there's a lot of animosity and jealousy between you and the Mouth of the South.
No, there isn't.
There isn't.
Oh, no, we made a very good business deal. Adrian,
for Bundy, cash. No, things work out fine.
How can you trade away a guy to come out of the closet for 500 pounds of humanity?
It's simple. It's business. It's the way I operate.
A lot of money change hands in that deal?
That's personal. I don't have to disclose the amount of money.
Well, I didn't
money
ask you for the amount.
Well,
I just
you were
said
going
was there
to. That
a lot
was your
of
next
money
question. I know
hands.
You. Usually when I'm grilled like this, I at least get my rights read to me. I'm not
grilling you, Bobby.
Well, you're giving me a hard time. I come out. This is my second week out here. You called people.
This could be your last week out here, too.
This could maybe be your last week.
Unless,
maybe they
unless
can change
the body calls and begs again to have you sit in for him.
Well, anytime
the
body
gets done with that movie pretty soon.
Anytime the body wants me to help him, I'll help him. I enjoy doing this. We're going to enjoy doing a lot more things in the future.
Plenty of action, as always, here on Primetime Wrestling. Stay tuned. Coming up,
Gorilla
Action. We're back, wrestling fans. Bobby, I just want you to sit back and relax and don't get hyper on me. Don't get bent out of shape. I'm going to treat you like a gentleman. You are a gentleman. I'm going to treat you like a gentleman. Some of the remarks that I make to you may sound derogatory because they're the truth, and the truth sometimes hurts a lot. You asked earlier on in the program who could slam your guys, King Kong Bundy and Big John Studd. Coming up, we got a guy that can, Ted Arcidi, world's strongest man. 705.5-pound world record bench press. Is that not strong enough?
Well, it's strong enough if you got the mind to do it. The man has no ability yet, no wrestling ability. He's virtually a rookie. Now, for him to get under a man, you got to know how to slam a man. Sure, it's a lot different laying on some bench all day when I was wearing a size medium T-shirt, sucking down a half a can of tuna fish and 12 dozen eggs, and you think you're strong. You gotta use your brains.
Well, let's go to the ringside right now and take a look at the world's strongest man and see if he does have it.
He don't have it.
Right from Welland, Ontario, Canada, weighing 270 pounds, Chuck Simpson. And his opponent from Boston, Massachusetts, weighing 285 pounds, the world's strongest man, Ted Arcidi.
Well, I think we'll have some test of strength here in this particular matchup. Chuck Simpson against Ted Arcidi. Arcidi holding a world bench press mark at a little better than 700 pounds, I believe. And looks like he could do it.
Well,
Simpson,
I
don't think he wants to try it out again. Yes, he does, to the rope. Oh, look at this. Arcidi displaying awesome power.
He's got awesome power, as you say, Ben. It's extremely powerful. Yet look at him. He's got a tremendous physique for a guy 290 pounds. He's just amazing in the strength department. And actually, you know, he's a pretty fair wrestler, but he doesn't have to use much of his wrestling skills because he's so powerful that he just does away with his opponent just with sheer strength.
Arcidi sending Simpson for the ride. And Simpson decides to take a little powder. Ted Arcidi with that very thick, heavy Boston accent. Have you had an occasion to chat with Ted?
Yes, I've chatted with him quite a bit, and I think he's a very, very nice fella. Yes, he does have that Boston accent. He is a Bostonian. But very proud of it, by the way. But he's a very humble fellow, you know. He's
outside
very
the ring, he is. Inside, he's yes. Something else.
Well, inside the ring, it's all business. And right now, he's out to. He wants to use his strength the best to his advantage because he wants to climb that ladder. And he realizes as he meets tougher and tougher opponents, he's going to require more than his strength. But for right now, he'll just use his strength. Look at this. The fellow's going to try to hip toss
him. Nice block. Arcidi with Simpson on his feet, and look at that. Break in the face by Simpson. Simpson dropping the elbow. Simpson now with a right hand to the side of the head, trying to wind up Ted Arcidi. And a reversal by Arcidi. Oh, wow, what a clothesline.
He really put a his weight behind, and he really put a snap to it. He really hurt Simpson.
Simpson on his feet. We'll see what Arcidi will do with him here. Forearm to the back. You could hear that one.
You could hear Popolo over the roof of this arena. And here comes a backbreaker.
And Simpson across the back. The backbreaker. And that is all she wrote. So Ted Arcidi victorious with a backbreaker. World's strongest human being in the bench press.
Your winner, Ted Arcidi.
You know, there are a number of wrestlers lifting a 500-pound bench press, but not too many come close to the 700-pound mark, as Arcidi has.
Not too many come close. Nobody comes close. This man is in a class by himself.
What do you mean he stole the backbreaker from Big John Studd?
He did. Everybody knows Studd used that.
Nobody has a patent on any particular hold.
No, but he has enough brains to come up with his own
would
maneuver.
Would you admit that he has enough strength to slam
Well,
now
this is what I'm thinking.
Men?
I'm thinking now I can make this man
there
a
There was another
man.
Guy doing color commentary oh, there that has enough
the
power.
The living legend.
There's a guy
Big
that
deal.
Slammed
the
Haystack Calhoun at 601 pounds. Either one of your guys even
it.
Comes close
I didn't
to that.
See that.
I did.
Oh, I don't care what you saw.
I did. I was there to see it.
I'll tell you where Arcidi could make a lot of money, though.
What is that?
He could open up his own garage, save the money of having a grease rack, and he's so strong, he could just lift cars all day, and those dumb mechanics can come and grease the cars all day. He could
you're
just do that all day
You're
long.
Actually admitting that the guy is that strong, but you won't concede.
But it's a difference lifting weights than lifting a human being.
The waiting time is over. Your two men ready to go into action here on Primetime Wrestling. I bet you they can't wait to get their hands on a British Bulldog.
Oh, can't wait to get their hands
They're
on Hulk Hogan.
They're
going to
have a tiger by the tail when they do.
What makes you think so?
Well, because those two guys, although small in stature, are lightning quick, possess tremendous strength for their size. And they could give your guys a real rough time.
A good big man will always beat a good little man. Two good big men will always beat two good little men. And five good big men will always beat two little men. Sud and Bundy are like five people.
I agree with one statement, and you didn't even make it. And that is, a good little man never ever beat a good big man. But this is in single competition. In tag team competition, anything can happen. As did to Brutus Beefcake and Greg Valentine.
Well, like I said, I wasn't there. That's none of my business.
Just take my word for it, Bobby. I was there.
Take your word for it?
You haven't reached the end of the program yet, and you may not. We're going to go down to ringside right
you,
now for
you
our
can't get
feature
away with
match.
Threatening me like that.
Two big behemoths, King Kong Bundy and Big John Studd, along with their manager. Let's go.
Tag team attraction scheduled for one fall. Introducing first to my left, manager Bobby the Brain Heenan.
Manager of the year.
Here is his tag team combination. From Atlantic City, New Jersey, weighing 458 pounds, King Kong Bundy. And from Los Angeles, California, weighing 364 pounds, Big John Studd. Their opponents from New York City, weighing 235 pounds, Jim Powers. And from Atlantic City, New Jersey, weighing 235 pounds, Michael Saxon.
That's Michael Saxon, not Michael Jackson, in case anyone was confused. I don't think anyone would be, but nonetheless. Jim Powers, Michael Saxon. The lockup with, as we stated earlier on, as Bobby the Brain Heenan takes a look at perhaps the most awesome tag team force in the World Wrestling Federation today, Studd and Bundy.
Boy, that's for sure, Vince. You're talking about, look at Studd. What an impressive man. 6'8" or 9", 367 pounds, extremely well put together. Then look at Bundy. My goodness, looks like a Sherman tank.
He really does. Power is no slouch in his strength department either, but an excellent athlete. But you can see the complete contrast there as he attempts to literally stand up to Big John Studd. Studd is a giant. He claims to be really the only giant in professional wrestling, attempting to somewhat demean Andre the Giant, which perhaps is impossible to do. Look at this now. Bowers attempting to slam Big John Studd and could not get the job done.
Well, he may not be a giant, you know, like Andre the Giant, but both of these two, in my opinion, they are giants. How many people around the world are you going to see their size?
Bundy with Bowers whips him to the rope, sets him up. Tag is made now. Michael Saxon coming in. Bundy, by the way, in the New York Daily News, about a month ago, I guess it was, Bundy was issuing a challenge to Refrigerator Perry. Obviously not in a wrestling standpoint, but the 40-yard dash, arm wrestling. Anything Perry wanted to face him with, Bundy was ready to go.
What happened? No response from the Refrigerator?
I don't believe we've heard any as of yet. But Bundy said if Perry is the Refrigerator, he's the deep freeze.
Well, you know, this Refrigerator, really, when you speak about him in reference to wrestling, he's not that big. He weighs 305. Now, that's a big man at 305, but here we see two people in ring, one at 458 pounds and Studd at 367 pounds. So, you know, the Refrigerator would not look that colossal at all next to these two. He would look like just a heavyweight.
Good point. Is over the hip goes Michael Saxon. And we hear the chant that I'm sure we're going to hear sometime during the match. Everyone rooting and cheering for Andre. Andre. Ooh. Tag has made Big Bundy through the ropes. And yeah, you're talking about big men in different sports and whatever it may be. And you're talking about how huge Bundy is and huge Big John Studd. But then when you compare them to Andre, it's unbelievable. I mean, Andre is just literally in a category unto himself. The man is awesome.
Andre is the giant of all giants. When you're talking about a man over 500 pounds, 7'4", I mean, there are people 7'4", a few basketball players, I imagine. But what do they weigh? 230, 240, 250, maybe 260. But you're talking about Andre the Giant over 500 pounds. He is the biggest boned man that I, and there have been some giants through times, but Andre the Giant, my goodness, his bones, his skeletal frame alone must weigh 300 pounds. He is truly the giant of all giants.
Andre would probably make Goliath look like a midget, and look at this, oh my.
Right now, Michael Saxon thinks he's in there with Andre the Giant with those blows.
This is not exactly the greatest. Oh, look at this. Now, I haven't seen this before. Oh, no! Saxon's gone. Forget about it. The referee should stop the match right now. He's not going to give him that. Boom! An elbow under the chest. Please get it over with. Bundy insisting on the five count. King Kong Bundy with Big John Studd, and there we see literally the brains behind the brawn, Bobby the Brain Heenan.
The winners of this bout, King Kong Bundy and Big John Studd.
Wow.
Now play it again. Play it again. I want to see that thing over. I want to see that thing played again. Just a minute. Turn that on again. I want to see that thing played again.
We're not going to see that again. Just turn around and pay attention.
Your hands
to
off me.
I give credit where credit is due. It is an awesome team. Tremendous power. Tremendous, it appeared to me, continuity. They had continuity.
Of course they had continuity. What do you think? I got a couple of ham and eggers out there? These are great athletes. These are people I have molded. Anybody, I could take Arnold Skolin and make him world champion today if I could get a match with him. I could have Skolin back in shape. I could have him in that ring like that, just with what I know in my head. And
I put Stud and Bundy together.
That
the most
be a
unbeatable tag
big
team in
task
the
to do something like that.
No, I don't think so. Maybe for the average run-of-the-mill manager or the average layman out there. You people that work 8 to 5, punch those time cards, come home, have a lukewarm TV dinner, have a half a can of warm suds, and then your wife slaps you around the room all evening.
Please,
for you kind of guys.
What are you talking about?
For the average people out there, they have the big T-shirts with the holes in them.
You've got diarrhea of the mouth sometimes.
Well, can I tell the truth?
Run on and on and on.
No, I don't. I don't believe I do that at all. I believe I make a lot of sense of what I say.
Can I see Buddy's
suds
match
again? No, we're not
going
to see it again. Well, that wraps up another week here on Primetime Wrestling, and amazing how fast the time can go by.
Yeah, spending 2 hours with you is like spending half an hour in Omaha, Nebraska on a sunny day.
Well, I'm sure that the feeling is mutual.
I don't mind your company. We just don't agree on certain things.
Well,
that's obvious. And
that's fine.
Obviously, that's just fine with me.
I will say this. I will give credit where credit is due. You have a tremendous team in King Kong Bundy and Big John Studd, and I believe the Bulldogs may be in a bit of trouble.
That is correct. You know, I don't have to sit here week in and week out and take this, you know. I could be on Carson.
You don't worry, you're not.
What do you mean I'm not?
You will not be sitting here week in and week out.
Well, if Jesse's
the body
I know
will be
gonna,
back.
I know what's going to happen.
The movie
to the
star
body.
Will come
I know
back.
What's going to happen.
What's going to happen?
He's going to be living next door to me in Beverly Hills. He's going to be dating starlets. I can just see the whole trend changing now.
No
They'll
way,
probably
shape.
Change the award. They won't call it the Oscar anymore. It'll be the Jesse.
No way, shape, or form. Don't forget,
that's
wrestling
gonna
fans.
Happen. I know that's
every Wednesday
happen.
Here on USA Network, TNT with Vince McMahon, Lord Alfred Hayes. 8 o'clock Eastern Time, 7 Central, and also on Sunday afternoon, All American with my good friend Mean Gene Okerlund, and a whole bunch of tremendous matches that come out of there all the time. And you have a great deal of time on that program as well, so you're getting plenty of coverage.
Could you do me one last favor?
Yes, go ahead.
Just one last favor. Could you just roll my match again?
Not going to be anymore.
I'd just like to see that again.
Come on soon.
There's got to be somebody back there that can roll that. I'm not asking for much.
Not going to.